Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It is true that we are living in very turbulent and chaotic times. 2020 has been turbulent, has been chaotic. Now, given that we are in turbulent and chaotic times, we thought it prudent to put out this video detailing 12 important, very important tips/guidelines to help us cope and deal with COVID-19. Now, these tips/guidelines are based on the teachings of the Quran, the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, and guidelines put forth by WHO. Tip number one, stay at home. Do not travel unless there is an absolute necessity, and that too only do so with the permission of your authorities. The teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam clearly outline, clearly state that one should not travel from or to a place where a contagious disease is spreading or has broken out. Now, since the virus has spread all over the world, stay at home and protect yourself and your loved ones. My dear brothers and sisters, remember, it's just not only about us. We need to think about others. The elderly from amongst us and those with weaker immune systems or complicated medical histories are most susceptible in this regard, and we need to look out for them. Likewise, staying at home vastly helps the medical staff and others on the front lines battling COVID-19. Moving on, tip number two, social distancing. Maintain at least 1 meter, in other words, around 3 feet of a distance between yourself and others. Now, based on certain narrations of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, now the authenticity might be debated in regards to these narrations, but we read the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam endorsed social distancing from lepers during his time due to the contagious nature of leprosy. Now, the same logic applies to a contagious disease like COVID-19. Moving on, tip number three. And this is an important one. I do it often and I remind people a lot in regards to this, even before the pandemic. Wash your hands. Hand washing remains the number one tip for preventing the spread of coronavirus COVID-19 as per medical resources. It's common sense and it works. However, it must be done properly and with soap and water. When soap and water are not available, the next best option is to use an alcohol-based hand sanitizer. Now, I know the minute I mentioned alcohol-based, questions could arise. So you might be thinking, please explain, Sheikh. Now, according to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is forbidden to consume alcohol or alcoholic beverages. It is haram, it is forbidden to even consume a small amount of alcohol, even a small amount. However, scholars have differed on the najasa aspect or the physical impurity of alcohol. Some of them consider it najis, in other words, physically impure, meaning that if it touches the body and the clothes, then it must be washed. But there are others, a great deal of others, who do not consider it najis, who do not consider it physically impure. There are many scholars who have allowed the use of rubbing alcohol and the use of perfumes that contain alcohol. And I personally sympathize with the scholars that allow it, that permit it. Now, coming back to hand washing, please bear in mind that proper hand washing cannot be emphasized enough. It not only reduces the spread of COVID-19, it can also prevent the spread of other viral illnesses such as colds and the flu as well. Moving on, tip number four, avoid touching your face, your eyes, your nose and mouth excessively and unnecessarily. Research suggests that you may touch your face somewhere around 16 to 23 times an hour. Now, to be more specific, you should avoid touching your eyes, nose and mouth with unwashed hands. You see, this face off recommendation is extremely important, because respiratory viruses such as the new coronavirus and flu viruses, as well as a number of other nasty microbes, can make their way into you by first sticking to your hands and then being rubbed into your eyes, your nose or your mouth. Moving on, tip number five, sneeze responsibly. Cover your mouth and your nose with your bent elbow or tissue when you cough or sneeze. and then dispose the soiled tissues responsibly. Now let's talk about sneezing. Sneezing is indeed a huge blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we praise Him for it each and every time, following the sunnah of our father Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. A sneeze is a semi-autonomous convulsive expulsion of air from the lungs through the nose and the mouth, usually caused by foreign particles irritating the nasal mucosa. So the function of sneezing is to expel mucus containing foreign particles or irritants and to cleanse the nasal cavity. Sneezing is a mechanism that your body uses to clear the nose. So you see, when foreign matters such as dirt, pollen, smoke or dust enters the nostrils, the nose may become irritated or tickled. When this happens, your body does what it needs to do to clear the nose. It causes a sneeze. And a sneeze is one of your body's first defenses against bacteria that is invading or bugs, you know, a foreign particle basically. Now, research suggests, now this is where it gets interesting, and this is how it's connected to this particular tip. Research suggests that an average sneeze or cough can send around 100,000 contagious germs into the air at speeds up to 100 miles per hour. Allahu Akbar. Therefore, it is essential not to soil surfaces and the air in public gatherings. And thus, from this we understand that one should not sneeze into one's hands intentionally. If it happens, then you must immediately and thoroughly wash your hands. To avoid this, the Prophet ﷺ, he used to sneeze into his yad in the Arabic language, which is translated as his arm or the clothes that he was wearing. See, because during their time, my dear brothers and sisters, they never had the luxury of tissues and handkerchiefs. So any hadith that suggests the Prophet ﷺ used to sneeze into his two hands, cupped to his face, is considered either weak by the scholars or not to be practiced due to the fact that we have more authentic ahadith that clearly indicate that the Prophet ﷺ used just one yad, one hand or arm. And the fact that the Prophet ﷺ never used his right hand for anything of a dirty or lowly nature. Now we see that even when you go to the toilet, when you, after relieving yourself, you're supposed to cleanse yourself with your left hand and not your right hand. So anything of that nature, the Prophet ﷺ would always use his left hand. So a study of all of the ahadith indicates that it was never the hand slash palm that was used by the Prophet ﷺ, but rather the forearm and inner elbow area to sneeze and cough into, which is also called the yad. The narration of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, which states the Prophet ﷺ used to raise his hand to his forehead, proves that the Prophet would actually sneeze into his arm or sleeve, because he would raise his hand to his forehead. The hand, as in the palm itself, would not become soiled. Moving on, tip number 6, follow the law of the land. As responsible Muslims, it is upon us to follow the law of the country we are living in, as long as it does not force you to indulge in sin. It is upon us to cooperate with the authorities and our local scholars and help them in the fight against this virus, against this pandemic. If lockdowns and curfews are in place, do not congregate for prayers. Do not congregate for Jum'ah or Taraweeh in Ramadan. And remember, my dear brothers and sisters, Islam teaches us to be moderate and balanced in all aspects of life, whether it is religion, worship, relationships, ideas, or daily activities. This principled moderation is one of the defining characteristics of a good following of Islam. Our Maker subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the noble Quran, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ وَيَكُونَ الرَّسُولُ عَلَيْكُمْ شَهِيدًا. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, thus, we have made you a justly balanced community, that you will be witness over the people and the messenger will be a witness over you. The ayah is in Surah Al-Baqarah, which is the second chapter, ayah number 143. So my dear brothers and sisters, moderation is the center point between two extremes. Every one of our virtues sits at the moderate center of two vices that stray from it. Our goal should be to find that center point and always return back to it when we move away from it. You see, according to the hadith in the book of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam rebukes those who went to extremes in their faith. We have a hadith where we have certain individuals. One of them said, "For me, I shall offer prayer all night long." Another one said, "I shall observe fasting perpetually and I'm never going to break my fasting." So this hadith talks about three individuals. Another one said, "I shall abstain from women and I will never marry." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then comes to them and he asks them, "Are you the people who said such things?" And then he goes on to now clarify, subhanallah, he says, "I swear by Allah that I fear Allah more than you do, and I am most obedient and dutiful amongst you all unto Allah. But still, I observe fasting sometimes and I break it at other times. I perform optional prayer at night sometimes and I sleep at night sometimes. I also marry." And then he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to say, "So whoever turns away from my sunnah," in other words, from my way, "is not from me." My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the same Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was patient and understanding with the man who admitted to committing zina, the same Prophet who was patient and understanding in regards to the man who admitted to drinking alcohol, the same Prophet who was patient and understanding in regards to the man who enters his masjid and urinates in his masjid, defiles the masjid, the Prophet was patient and understanding. This Prophet becomes upset and rebukes these three individuals, although all that they wanted to do was only to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one begins to wonder why. It is because of how much of harm they could cause to themselves on the long run if they did what they had promised. Then imagine, my dear brothers and sisters, how much more careful we should be to avoid putting ourselves, our families, and the society at large at risk and in harm's way in the name of practicing Islam. Moving on, tip number 7. Be in constant dua for yourself, your family, and mankind at large. Along with your personalized du'as, ensure that you read your morning and evening adhkar and other du'as taught to us by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. For example, we have this du'a where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he tells us to read, "Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-barasi wal-jununi wal-judhami wa min sayyi'il asqam." Where you say, "O Allah, I seek refuge in you. I seek your protection from leprosy, from madness, from contagious diseases, contagious and evil diseases." Look at this dua, powerful dua, and how relevant it is for the landscape that you and I, we are in, for the times that we are in. So let us adhere to this teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and let us try to read this dua, the next guideline, the next action item, the next tip. Feed the needy and look after your neighbors, the people around you. It is our Islamic duty to look after those who need our help in whatever ways we can, to the best of our capacities. It is a responsibility upon our shoulders. Tip number 9, be productive. You see, you've got all the time that you would want with you, subhanallah. All the time that you need. So therefore, spend this time wisely. Spend your time productively during lockdown. As the month of Ramadan approaches, the month of the Quran, dedicate time where you would spend that time with the words of your Maker subhanahu wa ta'ala. Increase the recitation of the Quran, the study of the Quran. read beneficial books, watch beneficial content, spend quality time with your family. Keep tabs, call, check up and keep tabs on your relatives, your friends, and yeah, binge watch all you want. Binge watch beneficial content. Binge watch beneficial videos online and avoid wasting your time, my dear brothers and sisters, because we're going to be questioned about the time that has been given to us. So let us avoid wasting our time. Let us come out of the lockdown. Let us come out of, you know, quarantine and the curfew, that the curfews that are in place, much more productive, much more skilled and talented, after having learned things and after having, you know, educated ourselves during this period of time. Do not give in to the traps of shaitan where you procrastinate and come out an even worse person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Ameen. Moving on, tip number 10. Self-quarantine and seek medical help if required. My dear brothers and sisters, self-isolate immediately if you develop symptoms related to COVID-19, such as a fever, cough, or difficulty in breathing, and seek medical attention immediately. Your health ministries, your health authorities would have put forth directions and guidelines. There may be hotlines, there may be hospitals that you would have to get in touch with. Follow the directions of your local health authorities. And from a dini, from an Islamic perspective, the sunnah is to tie your camel and place your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, seek the medical help necessary, the medical help that is out there, and place your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the Almighty. Tip number 11. Focus on the rewards. Based on the prophetic teachings, a believer is rewarded for any form of pain endured. Allahu Akbar. How beautiful. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no believer is pricked by a thorn or more, but that Allah will raise him 1 degree in status or erase a sin. Look at how magnanimous and generous of a Lord is, subhanallah. And this hadith is recorded in the book of Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim, rahimahumallah. In the worst case scenario, death from a pandemic, the likes of COVID-19, will be considered as martyrdom, inshallah ta'ala. This is based on the hadith where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, there are 7 martyrs besides the one who is killed in the way of Allah. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to mention them. The victim of a plague is a martyr. The one who drowns is a martyr. The one who dies of chest pain is a martyr. The one who dies of a stomach-related sickness is a martyr. The one who burns to death is a martyr. The one who is crushed under something is a martyr. And the pregnant woman who dies during labor, when giving birth, is a martyr. And this particular hadith is recorded in the book of Imam Abu Dawud, rahimahullah. So as you can see through this hadith, whether COVID-19 is regarded as a plague or not, there are 2 other factors in the hadith. The one who dies due to chest pain or the one who dies due to a stomach-related sickness or a sickness from within is considered a martyr. So those who have passed away because of the pandemic, we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises them in the high ranks of the shuhada. Ameen. So the final tip for this video, tip number 12, do not panic or lose your calm. No harm can come to you except with Allah's permission. Trust Him, like I started off the video, trust Him and rely on Him. Remember, what is supposed to afflict you will never miss you, and what is supposed to miss you will never afflict you. This is kind of what I started off the video with. Place your trust in Allah. There is a light at the end of the tunnel. And based on the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we are supposed to tie our camels and then place our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In other words, take hold of all of the resources. Listen to what your authorities are saying. Listen to the guidelines being put forth. Adhere to these guidelines. And inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring about normalcy. We pray unto Him subhanahu wa ta'ala as we conclude this video. We pray that Allah brings about normalcy. We pray that Allah forgives us of our sins. We pray that He forgives us of our shortcomings. And just as how He united us across this video, we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unites each and every one of us in the beautiful gardens of Jannah. Ameen, ameen. Wa akhir da'wa ya. Anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Jazakum Allahu khairan.